my story, it's sad but true. It's about a girl that I once knew. She took my love, then ran around with every single guy in town.
Hey, hey,
whoa.
Diamond dancing early. In New York, we counting knots. Living at the top. AP on me, Millie Rock.
Stick 50 in the Glock.
Now we ride around the city, sipping, walking, playing rock.
Shit, I just spit my pop.
Fuck. Now I'm pissed off.
Hope you don't know what a perk
shit
is.
Then be my friend.
And help me see all of the serpents.
30, no 10.
I took 5, that's a fin. Had me limping like a pimp.
You will never understand. It's complicated, isn't simple.
Life simple. He in my way, I could kill him.
Blah.
Simple. I'm feeling bad, pop a pill.
Geekin'.
Simple. That's the type of shit to be up on my mental.
Enough of the intro. Now it's time to see the content you guys have come here for. We hop into the Aria 2-5 for $1,000 and get in the action right away. Doesn't take us too long to get involved in the action out here in Vegas. The first thing we have is 10-7 of diamonds when it folds to me in the hijack. I open up the action to $20 and we do see a call from the player on the button and then the big blind tags along as well. The flop brings no help to our exact hand. It is 5-4-4 with two clubs. On a board like this, it is a bit unfortunate because even if we hit a 10 or 7 or out may be dirty due to the flush draw on board, but I'm going to stick to the plan and rep over pairs. So I throw out $25 and we only see a call from the player in the big blind. At this point, I'm planning on shutting down on most turn cards, but another 4 is actually a really good one to continue to barrel on. If he has any sort of draw, such as a club draw or straight draw, he's really going to be disincentivized to continue now that any pair beats him being a full house. So when he checks it over to me, I'm going to stick to the plan and throw out a bet of $60. I don't need to go too big on the sizing just because, once again, all draws are pretty much going to fold, and he does decide to make the call. At this point, I can almost always put him on a 5, a pair between 6s and maybe 10s or so, and then also the pretty unlikely situation that he has a 4. So I'm planning on shutting down on most rivers unless it is an ace, king, 10, or 7. Also possibly a queen, but when the river rolls off a jack, I don't really think this card's that good for my range. Sure, it's an overcard, but at the same time, I really shouldn't have too many jacks the way I played the hands besides pocket jacks. So when he checks it over to me, I decide to give up and check it back, and thank the Lord I did because he goes ahead and shows 5-4. So he flopped the boat and turned quads, and we were stone dead pretty much on the flop. Nice hand. Let's try to reclaim some chips in this next hand. We look down at 6-7 of diamonds and the small blind, a pretty fun hand. We see a cutoff limp, and I'm in the small blind, and I decide to raise it up to $35. The blinds fold, and the cutoff makes the call. We go ahead and flop a pair on 6-7-10, but we also have a gutter to the dummy end of the straight, and then also a backdoor flush draw. So with that being said, I'm going to be calling a bet if he throws one out, so why not just set the price myself? So I continue with the betting lead and throw out $25, and he pretty quickly and happily makes the call. We're off to see another card, and the turn is a very good card. It is a 9 of diamonds. So now, instead of having a pair, we have a straight, but we also have a gutter to a straight flush draw, and then also any diamond will just give us a flush. So now's the question whether I want to be betting or checking, and I think checking is actually the better play here, because if we bet and he raises with a hand that contains a jack, we're not going to be folding all the equity that we have, so why not just pot control and go ahead and check it over to him. With that being said, he does throw out a bet. The cutoff throws out $75, 3 green chips, and for that price, nothing other to do than call, and we're off to see a river. The river is a pretty disgusting card. The river is a jack. So now there's a straight on board, and our two cards are irrelevant because the straight on board is higher than the straight that we have in our hand. So now is a question of whether we want to be checking it over to him or going ahead and betting. And the way that the hand was played pre-flop, I think I have slightly more queens than he does. So with that being said, I think a lead on this board will probably get a decent amount of credit. And the way he's played the hand so far, I don't think he can have many queens besides maybe queen jack. So I throw out $210, and after thinking for around 20 seconds, he decides to release his cards in the muck, and we do get a bluff through. We're not done with the suited connectors, and this next hand we look down at 9-8 of spades under the gun. Maybe a slightly bit loose in an 8-handed game, but regardless, this hand's too fun to not play. After bumping it up to 20, we see a call from the low jack and the high jack, and then the player in the cutoff, he actually decides to raise it up to $120. It folds back around to me, and this player has definitely been the action player at the table so far, putting in a lot of 3-bets and 4-bets, and then when the hand goes to showdown, the hand is really not that strong. So that being said, I definitely wouldn't be continuing with my hand, but now it's a question whether I want to be doing it in the form of a flat call or a 4-bet. I think a 4-bet is a little bit better, just to narrow out the field and possibly take down the pot now. So I put in that 4-bet to $285. This sizing was a little bit on the smaller side, considering that there are two other players in the pot, but I guess it doesn't really matter because they go ahead and release, and the cutoff player thinks for a while and does decide to make the call. So we did narrow out the field, so now we're going heads up to a flop out of position where the flop comes down 9 high with 2 spades. So we flop the absolute world, flopping top pair along with a flush draw. When you 4-bet 9-8 suited, you literally can't ask for too many flops better than this one. When action starts off on me, I throw out a continuation bet of around 20% pot for $130, and he quickly folds. Too bad we couldn't get too much action on this juicy flop, but regardless, happy to take it down with a pair of 9s. In this next hand, we're in the cutoff, and we look down at a baby hand. We look down at 5-3 of spades, and we open up the action to $20. We see a call from the button, and then the big blind tags along as well. Three ways to a flop where we go ahead and flop a flush draw on a 9-high board. When action goes ahead and checks to me, I definitely want to be betting with 5-high and a lot of equity, so I throw out a small bet of $20, and we do see a call from the player on the button. We're off to a turn, which is another 8, so generally this card is going to be a lot better for the opponent. But with that being said, we still have 5-high, and I think with a larger bet here, we can apply a lot of pressure to maybe any smaller pair, such as like 6s or 5s, and also maybe some draws that beat us, such as like 9-10, can fold. So I throw out $100, and unfortunately, this bet does not get too far, as the button practically min-clicks us to $250, so a tiny, tiny raise. A bit annoying, because there is a small chance that we are drawing dead if he has a hand such as pocket 4s, but I think what's more likely is him just having an 8 here. So now it's a question whether I want to be continuing, and I think with this sizing, I can peel one more, and he does have around $800 behind, so there definitely is a little bit more money to be played with if I do hit one of my spades. So I throw in $150, and we're off to see one more card. As the dealer peels that last card, I get a glimpse of black, and luckily it is the right suit, as it is the 6 of spades. So we go ahead and make our flush, and now action is on me. I think I want to be leading on this card for one of two reasons. One reason is that I can comfortably fold to a raise knowing that this player is most likely never raising as a bluff. And then two is if he has an 8, I do want to be getting value from that hand because it would be kind of a disaster if I check and he checks back an 8. So I decide to lead out for $400 and he goes well into the tank and looks pretty uncomfortable claiming that I am very lucky, in which he is not wrong. I did get pretty lucky. So at this point, I think he almost always has an 8. So I'm praying for a call after around 2 minutes of time passes. He does come to a decision, but unfortunately that decision is throwing his cards into the muck. So it looks like we might have thrown a little bit too much money in the middle, but regardless, we're happy to take down another decent pot with a pretty poor hand preflop. In this next game, we look down at the best hand in this game, pocket aces, and the action starts with a small blind. I gotta be honest, I forget if it was a straddle or if he opened to 15, but I'm pretty sure he opened up the 15, but I know that there was two calls. When action's on me, definitely not gonna be doing this in a cheesy limp pot, so we're gonna juice it up to $110, and we only see one call from the player on the button. We're off to see a flop out of position, which comes down at jack 7-8 with two hearts, so not the best board in mind, but we definitely can get value from a lot of draws. So when action starts off with me, I don't think I want to slow down, but I don't want to inflate the pot too much. I throw out $70 and the button does decide to make the call. So the turn peels a 3 of hearts, which brings in the front door flush. I think this is a card that I can either bet or check on. I think I actually like betting a little bit better because I'd imagine he probably play his flush draws a little bit more aggressively on the flop, or maybe a flop straight or flop set. So I pretty much still have the best hand, but regardless, I do check it this time for a little bit of pot control and maybe to induce a bluff, but unfortunately the button does check it back. So we're off to see a river, which is a total brick. So action's down on me, and now I definitely need to be going for a little bit of value. I think by him checking back the turn, he definitely does have some showdown value. Once again, by him not betting the flop or the turn, I can almost always guarantee I have the best hand here. So with that being said, I want to go for a lot of value. I decide to bet on the larger side because, once again, I think the line that I take may look a little bit bluffy and potentially could get called by maybe a weaker hand such as like an 8 or a 7. So I like in a larger sizing. I go up to $325, but unfortunately he doesn't think for around 5 seconds and finds the fold. So we're happy to take down another pot. Buckle up because this right here was the hand of the trip. The under the gun player limps and the middle position player raises it up to $35. The player in the low jack calls. I decide to make the call and the button calls as well. The under the gun limper gets out of the way, so we're going four ways to a flop. And before we see the flop, I want you guys to let me know which flop is probably the most desirable, but also the hardest to get value on. If you guessed flop quad eight, then you are correct. We go ahead and flop quads. Literally not a better feeling in poker, especially when it's a three bet pot and we are four ways to a flop. So sitting with an absolute nuts, the action does go ahead and starts off with the middle position player and he does not slow down and he does put out a rather larger bet. The middle position player bets $105 and action folds to me. It is always a question on how to play flop quads. It is something that I really have not looked up on, I haven't studied on, so I decide to just make the flat call and all the other players fold. Even though we have the absolute nuts, I think we can almost always put him on an overpair by barreling into three other people. So when I make the call, we're hoping to see a clean turn that probably won't kill much action, and the jack of spades actually looks really good. If he has aces, kings, queens, and possibly tens, he's probably going to continue to bet on this card, but unfortunately he goes ahead and checks it over to me. I think he could be doing this line with any overpairs to pot control a little bit, but at the same time, I don't think I can get three streets with flop quads anyways, so I check it back and we're off to see a river, hoping that he improves somehow. The river is an ace, so now a hand such as kings or queens might be a little bit timid around this card, but nonetheless, he throws out $300. Oh boy, we're absolutely loving this situation, and we're almost always putting him on a value hand with a line that he took. So he is around $650 behind. We only have one real decision to be done here, and that is move all in. I kid you not, he couldn't put a chip in faster and tables pocket jacks before I could even table my hand, and obviously, eights are going to beat jacks. What an absolute cooler. We go ahead and flop quads as he turns the effective nuts, which in reality, it is not the effective nuts because we have flopped quads. What an absolute cooler. And I really want to sympathize for this guy, but he was very friendly afterwards and he wasn't bickering. He wasn't agonizing. He was just kind of in shock along with everyone else at the table. In the moment, you do have to realize that spots like these just simply do not happen often enough. So you have to glorify them and like enjoy them while they happen because these literally are like once a year coolers possibly or like once every 6 months. But regardless, you know, it's just an absolutely sick hand that I'm super happy I caught on video for you guys. Anyways, after this one, our stack ballooned up to a crazy amount around $2,500 and we're absolutely killing this session so far. In this next game, we look down at King-Jack offsuit in the small blind position. The under-the-gun player straddles, and the plus one opens up to $35. He's definitely been a tighter player, and when he opens up from earlier position, this should almost always signify strength. A middle position player calls, and this time I actually decide to call, which, just to let you guys know, not to be results-oriented, this is just absolutely never should be the case, especially against a player such as him. This should almost always just be a fold. Occasionally, if a player opens up a little bit too light, then you can start 3-betting, but in this spot, this should almost always be a fold. But nonetheless, I do the worst option. I decide to make the call, and the under-the-gun player calls as well. So we're four ways to a flop, which comes jack high. Action goes ahead and checks over to the plus one player, and he doesn't stop betting. He throws out $70. The middle position player folds, and action's down on me. So here's a spot I got myself in. When I call preflop and flop top pair, can't go anywhere quite yet. I make the call and the under the gun player folds. The turn is a five of hearts, bringing a backdoor flush draw. I check it over to him and he definitely does not stop betting as he throws out a hefty bet of $165. So once again, I do make the call, and we're off to see a river, which is another total dud. It does pair the board, though. At this point, I really just want to get a showdown, so when I check it over to him, he has other plans as he throws out $310. So at this point, I'm kind of agonizing for playing the same preflop, and we got ourselves into a pickle. So now I'm getting around 3-1 on a call, meaning I have to risk $300 to win around $900, meaning I have to be right around 33% of the time. So this being said, he is repping a pretty narrow range after barreling three streets into four people and then myself. But with that being said, at the moment, I just couldn't find the fold, and I do toss in a call. And not to be results oriented, once again, this is just a bad play all around, but he does have pocket queens. So we will not be winning this pot, and we give off a little bit of our profits. A big card deck for some time after that miserable king jack hand, we throw on the straddle to try to get involved in the action under the gun. The low jack opens up the action to $30, and then the hijack player directly to his left raises it up to $80. So a pretty small raise, but regardless, the action so far looks pretty strong. The first player raises, the second player re-raises, and action does fold back around to me. Hopefully we have a good one. So we have aces. We're going to be putting in that raise. We bump it up to $200, trying to get maximum juicy value, looking like a squeeze, which in reality, I think I actually like a slightly larger sizing here for one of two reasons. One, it looks a bit like a squeeze, and then two, the smaller sizing by the hijack player and the low jack just opening up from early position, the ranges are just so strong, so they probably have good hands. The low jack player folds, and music to my ears, the hijack player ships $1,000 in the middle, and I go ahead and snap it off. The board comes out 6 high with 2 hearts. The turn gives us the nut flush draw, and the river, we go ahead and get the nut flush. The hijack player is shaking his head, so I go ahead and table my aces, and obviously, they are good. So luckily, we put on the straddle to inflate the pot preflop. We go ahead and pick up the best hand, and we take down a massive one. If you thought you were done with aces, too bad. I got them once again, and they are also in the red variety. So in this hand, there's a button straddle, and we're in the plus one position. We see two players call the straddle beforehand, and now when action's on me, I decide to raise it up to $75. So this table, it's late in the night, and we are in Vegas, so you know there's going to be a decent amount of action at the 2-5. That was sarcastic, but in this hand, we actually did get 3 calls, so we're going 4 ways to a flop. So when the flop comes down, king, queen, 4 with 2 clubs, I see about $150, and we only see 1 call from the player in the low jack, and he has a relatively short stack, so I'm planning on just putting him all in on the turn, assuming that it is clean. The turn is one of the best cards in the deck. It's another 4, so we have the best 2-pair combo possible, and I jam all in for his remaining $325. Unfortunately for us, that was all the action to be had in this one, and he lets his cards go. That was the last hand of the night. I appreciate all you guys for watching once again. Let's get out of here and hit the cage.